And good evening, church. It's good to see you here tonight as we continue on our discussion group series of New Testament churches. And last week we began one in which we started that had a lot of struggles, a lot of elements in it that they wrestled with, and a lot of that just stemmed from their lack of grasping who they were in the Lord. If we're God's people, if we are the children of God, if we are Christians, people who follow God, then God's identity and God's character and God's nature should define who we are. And that should happen from our internal being. Because out of that internal being, who we are in our heart and in our head, if we carry on the values of God, the perspectives of God, the priorities of God, then what comes out of us will be those same values, those same characteristics, the same love for one another that he extended as well. In our identity, we need to reflect God as much as possible. This week, we're going to look out of the 10 issues that we found in the Corinthian church that they struggled with in 1 Corinthians. We're going to look at those issues that if they had addressed with their identity, maybe they wouldn't have gone into them as bad. And it's the struggles that they had with one another. Because they didn't understand who they were in God, it opened up the door for many struggles that they had with one another. And while we hit those, they became a repenting church. And that's why we titled this tonight, because what I want you to know is this could have been a very disappointing letter that Paul wrote. And certainly it has its disappointments. If the ending of the story was that they refused to listen to his counsel or the wisdom of God, it would have been very disappointing. If you would turn over to 2 Corinthians chapter 7, and I want to make sure that we understand that there's hope in this. And the reason that we're looking at these churches is that we're trying to draw forth things that we can learn. And what we want to learn out of this tonight is really that there can be change once sin is confronted. There's going to be some very difficult things that we're going to talk about in the issues from tonight, like the degree that they tolerated sin and the kind of sin that was allowed to exist in their congregation. We're going to talk about the way they regarded and cheated one another, even in the courts of the unrighteous, rather than the wisdom of God within their own selves. We're going to talk about the way that they used their spiritual gifts, not for edification, but to create a hierarchy amongst themselves. There were several things that they wrestled with, for sure. But what I want us to really focus on is the fact that they repented. In 2 Corinthians chapter 7, we get this good news that's unfolding. And I covered this in a morning sermon, an AM sermon, a couple weeks ago. And this was with Titus coming back to Paul and giving him this report of the church at Corinth. Now, remember, as we said last week, there were several people that were involved in this congregation's development and growth. Certainly Paul, who writes the letter. Certainly Timothy, who would deliver the letter and be sent to them. Apollos as well. As you know, in Acts chapter 18, he was in Corinth. And certainly there's regard with him in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 through 3. But Titus was also sent there. Incredible leaders of the Lord's church were involved in this work. And what Paul is going to acknowledge is that Titus comes back and gives this incredible report. It's not about how they are failing in the issues they've had, but in the successes, because they've turned it away in very difficult situations. He says this in verse 2, "Open your hearts to us. We have wronged no one. We have corrupted no one. We have cheated no one. I do not say this to condemn, for I have said before that you are in our hearts to die together and to live together. Great is my boldness of speech towards you. Great is my boasting on your behalf. I am filled with comfort. I'm exceedingly joyful in all our tribulation. For indeed, when we came to Macedonia, our bodies had no rest, but we were troubled on every side. Outside were conflicts, inside were fears. Nevertheless, God, who comforts the downcast, comforted us by the coming of Titus. And not only by his coming, but also by the consolation with which he was comforted in you. When he told us of your earnest desire, your mourning, your zeal for me, so that I rejoiced even more." I love this next section. "For even if I made you sorry with my letter," there may be a reference back to 1 Corinthians. Some people think there may have been another letter between 1 and 2 Corinthians. Let's go with the 1 Corinthians. He wrote a letter to them dealing with their issues. So he says, "For even if I made you sorry with my letter, I do not regret it, though I did regret it.
For I perceive that the same epistle made you sorry, though only for a while. Now I rejoice, not that you were made sorry, but that your sorrow led to repentance. For you were made sorry in a godly manner, that you might suffer loss from us in nothing. For godly sorrow produces repentance, leading to salvation, not to be regretted. But the sorrow of the world produces death. For observe this very thing, that you sorrowed in a godly manner. What diligence it produced in you, what clearing of yourselves, what indignation, what fear, what vehement desire, what zeal, what vindication. In all things you proved yourself to be clear in this matter. Therefore, although I wrote to you, I did not do it for the sake of him who had done the wrong, nor for the sake of him who had suffered wrong, but that our care for you in the sight of God might appear to you. I love that passage because it shows the victory that can take place from people who are willing to listen, the victory that can take place when people are willing to confront sin. Tonight, when we go into our discussion groups, you're going to be talking about some things that are mind-boggling on some level, some very difficult issues that this church faced. But the reason we're going through this is so that you can see, okay, not that those people are worse than me, so I guess I'm pretty good. I think that's half the reason people watch reality TV. You watch the worst kind of people, like, I'm not that bad. We're not watching the Corinthian church for that reason, although they do have some tremendous issues they're dealing with. It could be that we also deal with some of those issues. We need to be prepared for that. It could be that you know someone that's struggling with some of these issues. We need to be preparing for that. But we need to be preparing for it in the context that success, victory can be had in the Lord. We see that there was repentance. We see that Paul, even though he had great struggles with what was going on, and it took so much effort writing 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians to send people like Timothy and Titus and Apollos to address these issues, there were so many people working for it, transformation occurred. There was a turning away from their iniquities and sins, and there was a turning to God. This is an encouraging book, not a disappointing one, because we know the end of the story. It comes about because of choice. A choice to confront sin in a very honest and loving way, to not be sorrowful that you have to deal with the sins, but also regretting because of the pain. There's a love that's in that relationship. I hope tonight, as we go into our discussion groups, you're willing to be open and talk pretty freely about what they're facing here, but also draw from it the ways that we can utilize this information to help bring about such transformation and willingness to confront sin in our own world today. That's what we hope to do. Tonight, we know this lesson's about confronting sin, and you may be in the midst of confronting sin. Tonight, you may have heavy burdens on your lives because you've made very, very poor choices. There is an answer for the problem of sin, and it's Jesus Christ. There's an answer for how you can take care of that sin, how Jesus can wash away that sin, and it's obedience to the gospel. Tonight, you may feel isolated and alone. You are not. God is with you, and God desires for you to be successful and to be with him in heaven. Tonight, you may be feeling isolated, sitting in that pew thinking, no one understands my life. These people couldn't possibly know what I'm going through. You might be surprised. The odds are someone else in this room has gone through it, is going through it, and would want you to be successful. They want to love you and be there for you. If there's a way that we can help you, if there's a way that we can pick you up, if there's a way we can edify you, if there's a way that we can go through this together, let us help. Let us know. Come forward as we stand and as we sing.